especially in America. I mean, European, you know, they have a longer traditions of folk music with a different attitude, right? With different religious. So the American style is, from the beginning, always religious in some way. You know? And, yeah, you know, that's where I grew up in the Nazarene Church, you know what I mean? So that's where I, everything's swimming around in my head. That's where it's coming from, you know, at that point.
You seem to gravitate towards the darker. Earlier today, we were talking about. I like the term apocalyptic because the true meaning of the word is to reveal something that was previously hidden. You know, people tend to think of it in always bleak terms, but sometimes an apocalypse can be really good news. You kind of gravitated towards those tones, and what I loved about it from the very beginning was that there was good news in those darker tales somehow. It was spun in there. It wasn't just murder ballads, although I love those too. It was something, you were finding streams of light in those dark corners in a way that I just had not heard other than maybe John Cash. Like, as an artist, as a songwriter, how were you navigating into those shadows to find that stuff? What was pulling you that way?
Well, that's a good example. Johnny Cash is a great example. I mean, that's one of the only records I had when I was a kid. We weren't allowed to listen to the radio or secondary music. You know, there was one Johnny Cash record, and then the rest was just, you know, church music, church groups singing, you know. So I had this. I think it was the Live in Folsom Prison.
Oh, man. So it's a good one, man.
That was like the only beacon of light that I was exposed to as a kid. And so, apocalyptic murder ballads. I mean, I would say that religion in general is a murder ballad. And that and Christianity, no different. It's a murder ballad. So I don't see such a stark difference, you know what I mean? But, apocalyptic understanding is, like you say, when people hear the word of apocalypse, you know, it's fire and death and terror, and there's plenty of that to go around. But this whole, that seems to be what drives why we were here in the first place to some degree, this apocalyptic vision of the end, right? And we have to be here to the apocalypse is going, you know, the Lord's coming back tomorrow. But of course, no one, and I mean no one, lives that way. You know, if that was the case, no one would be building churches or seminaries or
buying another pair of jeans.
Or whatever. You know what I mean? If, you know, you're supposed to all take this stuff seriously, but then no one does, so it's like, and that's as it should be, because that's not what's happening, you know what I mean? I mean, people want things to end, right? People want things to come to an end and things to be different, and I understand this attitude, but the whole apocalyptic revelation, horsemen, you know, this that's a really strange thing. Yeah, it's really strange. People get amped up about it at certain points in their life or by certain people that they're in communication with, and whether you're a Latter-day Saint or a, you know, it's always the end times, it's always the last days, you know, and you're like, oh, well, look at it, it's getting really bad now, you know, any day now, you know. Of course, today is the day, you know. Today is the day of the apocalypse. Today is the day of today is the day that Christ was revealed and everybody you see on the street, you know.
That, yeah, and I think that I listened to your new record most of the way on the drive up from Nashville to here, and it just pulled me deeper and deeper each time I went through it. It was like a meditation. And different songs, like I didn't have a notebook, I wasn't able to write stuff down, even titles I wasn't able to, and I heard some songs would have four or five different biblical references within them. You're jumping from the Old Testament to the New Testament. It's like a swirl, almost a psychedelic bombardment of imagery that's just breaking me down into a point where I can say, I want this apocalypse or this revelation to happen. Like, today is the day of the Lord. If my eyes could actually be healed, you know, when you reference that scales falling or the eyes opening, the healing that happens when we see. Did you have a particular mission that you were on as you constructed this particular project, or does the path kind of emerge as the song
comes? Yeah, I never have an idea of what I'm doing. I just do it, right? I mean, I'm collecting specific words or a series of words, maybe an actual sentence. I just collect them, right, like pieces of a puzzle. And then the music this time was more made by some other guys in the group that, you know, that was kind of a new thing. Normally I come up with all this stuff and then we work it together, but I just let them do it, right? And so I just concentrated on the words for the most part. And, so yeah, we get the music made and then I kind of live with it for a little while and just trying to throw these words on it. And I don't really try to make sense of anything. I just kind of let it come out the way it comes out. I'm not really concerned that it's going to have a story anymore. I didn't have anything, you know, specific that I'm trying to communicate other than just what's in my own mind, you know, however fractured it may be. I mean, it always ends up becoming something after the fact, you know. It kind of realizes itself after the fact. And I don't even know what the songs are about until like a year later, you know. And even then, what I think they're about is going to be completely different than someone else.
Yeah. I mean, your stuff is unique, almost like a Bob Dylan or something, where I can go back. I can hear Black Soul Choir now, and oh my gosh, it sounds like you could have written it about politics in the last couple of years, or you could have written it about the way theology has broken down or people's ability to be like, and now that's me reflecting off a piece of work that's, what, 25 years old. That's a sign of a good freaking song. Like, but I've had songs, you know, that I've written that I go back and I'm like, oh, that's not what I had in mind at the time. And now my own song is preaching to me a little bit.
Okay.
That's really cool. The sound is even different. So I guess that makes sense. You're saying that the other guys got to kind of take the reins a little bit. Because sonically, you've got a lot of different things going on orally. So that was because different people have the reins.
A lot of it is things that we recorded just over periods of years, you know, being on tour, being in a backstage somewhere, or being at a sound check somewhere, just recording the drums, recording some ambient noise in a hallway or something. And so we just collect all this stuff and then just make songs out of it, you know, even vocal tracks from other albums, you know, just slow down, play backwards, and then
that's so cool.
That's
fantastic. Were there some synth things in there too?
Oh yeah, a lot. Yeah. I played a lot of synth on this one.
Yeah, which I've not, so at least I haven't associated it with
your stuff. We haven't done so much in the past, but
it's great though that it doesn't take you off brand for like, who cares about that from a marketing perspective, but, and you're free to do whatever you want to do as an artist, it's consistent with the soul of what you've done, and yet it brings some new freshness.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing I can really do to get away from what I do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I'm not a guy that can branch out into something else, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But if I have people around me that bring in fresh, creative, you know, things, I can use that, but it's still going to end up, you know, having some sort of signature on it, right? But, so I can't really stray too far, even if I try.
Yeah. This might be weird, but as a singer, so you've got songs that you're writing, you've got the way that you're accompanying them, the guitar parts, the melodies even. Then you've got your voice and the way you're singing. And I love the way you're using your voice as an instrument. How much of that was developed, you're conscious of it, and how much of it is just kind of naturally, instinctively what's coming out when you're singing?
Well,
it's a very particular...
I'm not really a singer or a musician, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of a hack at both of them.
Which is very folk.
And so I just... You know, I'm not really accomplished at playing and singing at the same time. You know what I mean? So whatever I'm playing is going to dictate how the vocals come out, you know, when and how. When I have a pause, when I'm able, you know, because I'm not adept, you know, so I'm just... has created my own style out of these deficits, you know. But,
That's a good style. I think that some of the most compelling art is when artists are leaning into their deficits or weaknesses, that something that's perfect is not interesting. In my opinion, your voice and the timbre and the cadence, the way you're pronouncing words, the stretches, it feels like an instrument. It's almost like playing it like a guitar, and you're affecting it dramatically like an actor would deliver lines on a stage play at times. It's very powerful.
In my mind, it's very cinematic.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's like each song is like a movie. You know?
Mm-hmm.
And, I see it that way. It doesn't mean other people see that way, but that's how I, you know, I don't own the song. It's like the song is its own thing, and then when it comes time for me to perform it or whatever, I'm not in control of it, right? I'm just like a part of it, right? And so I just step into this, something that's already waiting for me, and I let the song dictate, rather than me dictating where the song is going to go. I kind of listen to the song more. And I'm affected by the sounds and the lyrical content, and because, like I say, a lot of times I don't know what anything means, and I'll be on stage, and all of a sudden something will mean something to me out of the blue, you know. And so that it's a strange relationship with it, right? I'm not really in control of it. That's not to over spiritualize it or something like that. It's just I'm not in control of it.
Your stuff has always had such a strong spiritual presence to it and focus, whether it's the specific lyrical content or the way it's delivered. And yet you've been so embraced by, you know, Tool and mainstream artists that are definitely not coming from any kind of Christian space, at least in terms of, you know, what they're known for publicly. Why do you suppose, or have you had any insight after all these years doing it, that other artists who would like to integrate their spirituality into their work might learn something about how they might be able to do that? A lot of people have been told this idea that they have to make gospel music or Christian music in another space because the rest of the world won't want to hear that. And so you either have to kind of shut up about that and make normal music, or you make religious music. And I feel like you're kind of proving that that's not true. You're able to do what you do, and it seems like everybody kind of respects you for it.
Yeah, I don't really, to be honest with you, I don't know why people take an interest in it at all. Be they religious or non-religious or whatever, it's just happened, right? I don't understand why, but you know, it would feel like some sort of arrogance or to even come up with a reason. You know, I don't, you know, to say that, oh, maybe they think it's got some sort of authenticity, right? Or well, try to come up with a word like that, you know, but I really don't know. They're just kind people, right? That for whatever reason, they like what we do and wanted to be involved in some way, to take us with them on tour, or to be have a friendship or whatever, you know. And yeah, I wouldn't want to presume, you know, what their intentions or their reasons were to be. You know, I'm just happy to have opportunities. Yeah.
Yeah. I've long believed and talked about this idea that I think all music is essentially spiritual. It can be used for secular purposes. You know, you might use music to sell a cheeseburger, you can, but something about the essence of music is spiritual. And that I think that when we're honest in our music and when we're passionate, we're getting to that kind of spiritual place. And I think we can connect with people that way. I feel like your music is the essence of that. Like, it's one of the best examples I've ever seen of that kind of thing. And I suspect that that's my, at least part, I'm going to generalize. But I've seen you play at bars full of people that, you know, I'm sure some of them are church-going people and some of them are not. And they're not, that's not on the agenda. That's not part of their calculus as to why they're there. But they're having an experience and it feels very sacred. The thing that's interesting, and as, ever since the first notes I heard, was just how upfront. There's lots of people that have some kind of, so you're so upfront about it, and that can sometimes be a turnoff, and it just makes your music that much more compelling to everybody that's listening to it. I think it's, you're just not shy about it. It's just right there in the
middle. Well, you know, I'm, like I said, I've been steeped in it since day one. You know,
right.
From then. I never really had a time of like not believing, you know what I mean? Like, oh, I'm not gonna believe that anymore, I'm gonna go do this or that, you know. And that is not to say at all that, you know, that's not a behavior. I'm not talking about behavior, right? I'm just talking about, you know, people have doubts about this or doubts, you know, I've never had any doubt that that every man, that every person is Christ. Never had any doubt about it, right? So it doesn't matter if the people have a proclamation of something or if they don't have or whatever. To me, every person is the Lord. So that's how I look at it.
You've leaned into also some kind of Native American elements of. Is that part of your heritage?
It is, yeah. Yeah, it was part of my life quite a bit growing up. And just in small towns all around, and there would be, you know, have Native people in the family and originating in Oklahoma.
Is it Cherokee?
Choctaw and Cherokee. And, so it was always something that the family was talking about, because everybody wants to be a part of it in some way, you know. But I just took a good 10 years and just basically, I don't really take vacations and things like that. I just go to reservations, right, and just be there, you know, not to, no agenda, just to be there. To me, that's America. I take my son with me. We just camp out or whatever, whether it's a powwow or whether it's just some other time of year. friends there, mostly in the Dakotas, some in Wyoming. You know, yeah, growing up, there would be like mission groups, you know, they'd go up to Pine Ridge and make bunk beds for the kids or whatever, you know. And, or if you go there, you know, you've got a huge LDS building next to a big Roman Catholic building next to a, and there's nobody in any of them, you know. As far as I know, there's nobody who goes, you know, they're just there. You go to the powwow and there's like a, you know, a white family, you know, three generations, they've been living on, their ministry, right, is toward the Native American people, and they have teepees, you know, and all this stuff set up, and there's nobody who won't talk to them, right? And they're there every year, and everyone just walks by them, right, but they're there handing out CDs or whatever, I don't know what they're handing out, but I just never saw that as a way to communicate with people, you know? When I see it, I feel as awkward as the people,
right?
It just feels awkward to me. I mean, I understand it's their calling or whatever they want to call it, right? But, I just look at it like, this is America, these are American people, you know, and I want to learn what it's like to be an American.
And you mentioned earlier about American music being essentially gospel and
yes, sir.
Native American music. You start talking about music being essentially spiritual, and you're like, of course. I mean, all of the music was connected to the spirit.
Well, spiritual is a really subjective word. You know?
Sure.
I mean, people, what's spiritual to one person is not at all to the next, you know. It seems like a general spirituality is, in my understanding, it's normally a way to try to understand or come to grips with something that is naturally true. I mean, nature is magical, right? I mean, like the landscape and the atmosphere and all of this is just like magic, right? And Native American people are really sensitive to these things, right? And I mean, believe me, you know, like I said, I'm from a Nazarene background, and you know, anybody that's quote unquote spiritual outside of that is a complete heathen. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Complete heathen. Straight to hell heathen. Right? Doesn't matter if it's spiritual or not, right? It's that kind of spiritual or whatever. But I think really, you know, like things like science and mathematics and these things originally were spiritual just because they were something that were not yet grasped in a way that was concrete to people, and I think that's still the case, that, you know, things that would seem spiritual in nature are just, this term, this spirituality is just it's like nature drawing you to understand it. Nature. Towards spirituality is, it doesn't have that in mind, right? It doesn't have learning anything really in mind. It has to do with affecting things, right? Changing things, changing behavior, changing thought processes, that's what the spirituality is used for, rather than to understand things around you. I mean, it's more there to direct than to learn.
Yeah, I'd say that that's definitely the modern reality. I don't really, I think that there's a more ancient form of Christian thinking that used art and reflection and
and discovering Rome.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about long ago, you know, we lost that. You know, people like Isaac Newton or somebody like that, you know what I mean? That things have a magical sense to them, and, but that magic is trying to communicate something concrete, you know, yeah. Something solid that in reality of the creation, right, of nature. And like I say, Christianity in general, I think they use spirituality as like a weapon. Whereas like the Native American culture is just, you know, giving reverence to nature, you know, and the magic, and letting nature be magic, right? You don't really find that in, I mean, yeah, you drive to the Grand Canyon and you're like, oh, how grand and glorious, you know, God's creation and all of this, but, you know, you're never gonna spend any time just a relationship with the land and the chemistry of it, you know what I mean? You've kind of put your stamp on it, and it's difficult to put into words, but.
Yeah, and it's our kind of motto we've landed on with the show, kind of our purpose for doing this is to listen to music better, and to listen to better music and listen to music better. Because I have the suspicion that one of the reasons music is so important is because it's kind of a practice ground for becoming better people. Like it can exercise certain muscles in our hearts and our minds, that we can become better discerners, we can become better appreciators of beauty, and it cultivates empathy for people and sparks imagination and vision and stuff that we've lost because we become consumers of music and consumers of art as opposed to appreciators and entering into it. And the idea that music and art can transform us, can transport us, can help us think and feel differently and critically. I'm just not ready to give up on that. And so those of us in this conversation, we're kind of trying to highlight artists and records and experiences that have sparked that, because sometimes we gotta slow down and put a record on and just concentrate and listen and stare at a candle or whatever it takes to have that. But I think that I've had conversations with some Native Americans who have said, like, well, welcome to the party, you know, we've been doing this for thousands of years.
Exactly. That's part of what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's, you know, music is innate, right? And it's just another language, just like nature is a language. And, yeah, you can't really control it, right? You can't really box it in. You just have to hopefully have a relationship with it in a positive, open way, right? I don't know what else to say. Yeah, it's difficult to live in a land where you know, there's this idea of the church, and then there's this idea of this manifest, this destiny, manifestation of what we're living in here, and I'm like, you know, so many decisions are made, so many directions are taken out of this mindset that, you know, we're living in the last days, right? I mean, the founding of America, right, is part of this idea that we're living in the last days, you know. So it seems really confused. Like I say, so many different things are created and institutions and at the same time, right? Like that are supposed to last long into the future, and generational places of learning, you know, all of this stuff coming from the people who say, you know, God's coming back tomorrow, right? So it's like, yeah, there's something there's something off here, and it, I think, you know, more often than not, it's just a sense, it's just used as a sense of control and to overpower other people, overpower other ideas, and to direct people in a way that you want them to go, for whatever reason. And I just try to step back from this attitude, you know. In my opinion, like I said before, the apocalypse is the person next to you is God. That's the apocalypse. That's, you know, that's the revealing, and that you come to realize that. And this, this whole idea of the revealing of the man of sin and all of this stuff, that's you. You realize that, you know, that that's you. And what is that? I have a different idea of what sin would be if I, than most people. To me, sin is believing in sin. That's sin. Simple as that.
So what's the answer to that then? Or what's the remedy?
Believing is knowing and come to the understanding that your neighbor is God. Your neighbor is eternal.
Okay.
Your neighbor is righteous and holy. And perfect in the eyes of the Lord. And who is the Lord? You are. You know, if you don't see your brother as righteous and holy, then
why would you treat him?
Right, I mean, then. Instead, you know, there's this idea we're going to take this to the people, right? In my opinion, God is the people. And you're not taking anything that you're going to get from them, right? You're going to get God from these people. You're not going to give God to anybody. You're going to get God from people, right?
We're the least of these, are there?
Yeah, well, there's, you know, there's so many different, like I was going to say, you know, people always talk about the church, you know, in politics or wherever. It's like, what church? What church are you talking about? Are you talking about the Baptists? Are you talking about the Methodists? Are you talking about the Presbyterians? Are you the Calvinists? What church? Roman Catholic Church? You know, people just use the word like everyone knows what it is. No one knows what it is. And everybody has a different opinion. You know, like I said, I grew up in Nazarene. Everybody here is going to hell. Everybody. Right? If you're not doing what is described by the Nazarene hierarchy, you know, if you step into a Baptist church, you know, adios. And people still feel that way, you know. Especially in the leadership positions of these denominations, or whatever you want to call them. And, you know, the world changes around them, and they don't like it, and of course, they have to, in some way, try to wrangle it, right? And, you know, the youth are starting to get involved in things that they don't like, and, you know, I grew up, you know, no playing cards, couldn't go to movies, right? Women couldn't wear pants, no makeup, you know, that type of thing, you know what I mean? And bragging about stuff like that. You know, I haven't had a beer my whole life. It's like, who cares? Who cares? I mean, yeah, what is the church? You know, it's like, I just saw the other day, you know, this woman from Colorado talking, you know, it's like the church has got to inform the government, not the government, the church, you know.
Oh, yeah, I saw that clip.
And I was like,
scary.
Oh my Lord. You know, I think most Christians would be like, well, yeah, you know, they would kind of agree that, you know, the church should be ruling the nation, right? And it's a Christian nation, one nation under God, right? All of that. But of course, no one agrees on what that means, you know, from one church on the corner to the next church on the corner. They have a different idea of what that means.
Wow.
I think a Celtic spiritual idea of seeing the Christ in others, something which you're talking about. We honor each other, we humble ourselves, and that is a revelation. That is a humbling and powerful. It's funny, we talk about apocalypse, when you reveal yourself and your clothes are going on, and make up these laws, and your hair is what it really looks like. You know, it's humbling, but it's also freeing. You know, I think, to me, when I say that the apocalyptic nature of your music has a good news essence to me, especially on this latest project. And maybe it's just where I'm at right now and I needed it, but it's like, the good news behind the apocalypse, even the parts that are like, it's all gonna burn, it's because all this stuff isn't necessary. So the burning of it is actually good for you. Because once this burns, you're gonna see you didn't need it in the first place. And the good stuff is, you're blind to the good stuff until the stuff that's a lie is gone in your life. There were several of these little lines that you kind of tucked into the songs that were hidden behind the scary thing. It was like this thing might be in your face and it's scary, but behind it is the good news. If you can't get past the scary thing, you never get to the good news. And we're so ruled by our fears, you know, that we're living with the monster in our face. And I've loved throughout your career your ability to sing about the monster in your face, the skull right here, so that we can eventually see that that monster is not real. Like, it's back here. The answer is, joy comes in the morning. I really appreciate it. I appreciate your attention and stuff, and your willingness to go there over and over again. And you're on kind of an island. You're unique in this art. You're doing something. You're a scene unto yourself. And I think it's been validated, obviously, by the people that have saluted you already. I just want to add my hat to that ring. Thank you for doing that. And I appreciate it. I know we all live here. Thank you for coming and doing it here. And the new record is great. Excited to see you back out on the road and through the COVID wilderness and all of the delays for that.
Yeah, it's been really tough.
Yeah, it's tough for a lot of artists this last couple of years. So, how can people best keep up with you and what you're doing and support you and keep wind of your sails? What's the best way for fans and friends to do that?
Yeah, I don't know.
Somewhere and go see
me, but yeah, you know, I mean, I do use, you know, Facebook and whatnot to communicate, you know. I'm a nightmare for the American companies.
I'll call them and give them an
the things that
I don't have to worry about.
They give me grief about posting Bible verses. Like, no one wants to read Bible verses.
I do. I love reading Bible verses. Especially those scary men.
But I don't know what else to do, you know. And so I feel like I'm, you know, my ministry in my, you know, that I don't like the word for those.
Just being conservative.
Is for people who are held by religion. Right? For people that are not religious, they don't really need what happens. To me, people that are religious are the ones that need to be free from religion.
Oh, wow.
Out of open, right? same thing that people are dealing with. A lot of people are quite adept at hiding that fact. Yeah, I'm really not fearful. I think religion is really feeds on this fear factor. Uses it in all kinds of ways that I think are detrimental to people and communities and life. Similar to, you know, the passage in Ezekiel talking about the covering cherub. You know, you were the covering cherub, you were the garden of God, walking among the stones of fire. Until iniquity was found within you, and your multiplicity of trade, and all of this, right? Talking about the king of Tyre. And to me, that's religion, it's the king of Tyre. Selling purple. Selling this idea of royalty and of spirituality. Fabric when in reality you have no need to be covered. The Spirit of God is your covering. It is your covering, and it's not going to leave you and make you naked for the world. God's not into exposing anybody, in my opinion. He's always covering. I've seen that taken in a really bad direction, you know, especially within the church. And you see it in the Roman Catholic Church, you also see it in the Evangelical Church, right? This idea of, you know, oh, we're going to cover over this, you know, that's not what I'm talking about. That's not what I'm talking about.
Oh, like that idea of love covers a multitude of sin, you know, or, yeah, I see what you're saying. I agree. I think that God wants us to be free of the things that are holding us back.
Well, vulnerable, what are the fears? You know, what are the fears? The fears of, well, I'm not doing what things well enough. I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. So I'm trying to, you know, be with the right people, do the right things, say the right prayer.
Edwards.